Hi there. My name is D.G Valdron. I'm a writer, enthusiast of science fiction and all things dark and demented. And we're here to talk about Lexx, baby. Now, Lexx is a television show that you've probably never heard of. Well, that's okay. That's kind of my stock in trade. If you haven't heard of it, I probably know about it. And I'm here to share these things. So, Lexx. There are two things that you need to know about Lexx. A television show that came out in the 1990s, early 2000s. And what you have to remember about this period of time is that it was dominated by Star Trek. From the 80s to the 90s, Star Trek ruled science fiction. Starting with The Next Generation in 87, there were no less than four consecutive overlapping Star Trek series. DS9, Voyager, Enterprise. Star Trek offered a singular vision of the future. We had Gene Roddenberry giving us an American century in space. A universe of confidence and progress where everyone got along, everything was orderly and organized. The forces of chaos had been beaten back or were pretty marginalized. The future in Star Trek was orderly and domesticated. And so, of course, people had to take a run at that. And so we got Battlestar Galactica, we got Farscape and Stargate, we got Firefly and Star Hunter. And Lexx was just one of these anti-Star Treks that came along. All of these shows offered a different vision of the future. All of these shows said, no, the universe will not be orderly, that the future will be chaos, and that it will be defined by human failures and frailties that we will have to struggle, not just against the cosmos, but against ourselves and against each other. And so, you know, the future was challenging. It was dirty and gritty and desperate, and people kind of ate that up. So that's the first thing you need to know about Lexx. The second thing is that the people that made Lexx, they were insane. They were out of their minds. They were demented because they came out of nowhere and all they had was just these wacky ideas that we'll go off into space and we will do strange things. And instead of an orderly spaceship, they had a dragonfly that blew up planets. The hero was a third-class security guard who really just wanted to find something, place safe. You show him something dangerous, he was going the other way. The heroine was a love slave who could never get laid, and she was a little bit cluster lizard. The tough guy was an undead divine assassin who could do literally anything, but because he was dead, he had no motivation to do anything at all. Lexx built itself as Star Trek's evil twin. It brought us a universe of chaos and disorder and great big science fiction ideas. It was probably one of the most interesting shows of its era, because it wasn't orderly science fiction. In fact, its influences were more European. So Lexx was actually a show that owed as much to cult filmmakers like Jodorowsky or Bunuel. This Lexx was the discreet charm of the bourgeoisie in space, or El Topo. It literally owed more to Barbarella than it did to Star Trek. So it was visually interesting, provocative. The stories were subversive and absurdist. It was suffused with a sense of humor that was very black, and nobody who showed up in Lexx in the cast or crew ultimately survived. Now, that's the opening. Lexx is actually a Canadian science fiction television series, but not just Canadian. It's produced out of Halifax, Nova Scotia, which is from the east coast of Canada, a small town or a small city called Halifax, Nova Scotia. The creator of Lexx was Paul Donovan. Donovan grew up in Nova Scotia and went to the London Film School and then came back to his hometown with the desire to make movies. He was never part of Hollywood. He was never part of the Hollywood cultural establishment. He wasn't Toronto or New York or Vancouver or California. He was just some guy with a camera. And like other regional filmmakers, he did interesting things. In fact, in some ways, he resembles John Waters both physically and in terms of his sensibility. Lexx came after several years of making movies when Donovan wanted to make literally a sci-fi series. It was intensely personal. Created and run by Paul Donovan, he would write many of the episodes. He would direct many of the episodes. He was the producer. He is sort of the vision that kind of like oversees everything. And most of the series was written by Donovan or two other writers, Lexx Jigaroff and Jeff Hirschfield. Together, these three wrote the overwhelming majority. It was an intensely regional production filled with local actors, designers, and crew members, and this gives the show a very interesting feel. Now, sometimes it's rough around the edges, but it's always different. There's always this different visual sensibility. There's this different aesthetic sensibility. There's this slightly different approach. It was a shoestring production, obviously. They didn't have a lot of money, but they were able to get investors from Germany. They were able to bring Showtime in. And this allowed the first season of four movies to be made. And they actually got some stars. Rutger Hauer, Tim Curry, Malcolm McDowell, Barry Bostwick. And from there, they went on to a second season of 20 episodes. And then the money ran out. They reconfigured. There was a third season of 13 episodes, which was completely redesigned. And then for the final season, they brought in the Science Fiction Channel and were able to do a fourth season, which really dramatically reconfigured the show and set it on Earth and gave it a much more absurdist tone. Lexx is a show about a giant dragonfly 10 miles long who's designed to blow up planets. Now, it was created by an evil empire because, you know, blowing up planets is very antisocial. But it was stolen by a group of misfits who managed to get away with it, and they absconded through the galaxy having adventures. And normally this would be wacky and fun, but nobody actually ever came out of an encounter with Lexx in very good shape. So this odd crew managed to bounce around through two universes and actually destroy both of them through four seasons. They would go to heaven and hell. They would come to Earth. They would see a great many planets. And in the end, they blow them up. There you go. Behind the scenes, Lexx was as deranged and imaginative and full of coincidence as anything you would ever see on the screen. The philosophy of the show was probably stated by Jeff Hirschfield. The impulse to heroism is the same impulse that sends you bumbling off a cliff. It was a show that said that humanity was imperfect and that actually was kind of funny. There you go. Now, basically, I discovered Lexx back when it was first on. I was blown away. I had never seen anything like this. As I said, this is a show that owed as much to Barbarella as it did to techno science fiction. It owed more to Bunuel and Jodorowsky than it did to George Lucas or Gene Roddenberry. Lexx was a show that was full of black humor and absurdist events, full of surrealism, full of ordinary people trying to survive in a chaotic and dangerous universe, and, you know, basically achieving mixed results. Nobody ever really succeeded in Lexx, but they survived, mainly. Nobody truly won, but they managed to kind of get through things. And I thought that was amazing. So I became a huge fan. And eventually I got to know people involved in the show, and eventually they invited me to write a book about it, which didn't get written way back in the day. But I had tons of access. I got to speak to the creators and the actors. I got to speak to the props people and the carpenters and the costumers, and especially the writers, and sort of, you know, just go right in and dissect and say, where does this idea come from, and how did you come up with this, and do a complete autopsy of the show while it was actually going on. And so eventually, after many years had passed, I took all of this research and put it into a book, into a series of books called Lexx Unauthorized, which is up there on any of your book platforms. Take a look. I'll be talking about Lexx again in some of these videos, and I'll be talking about some of the more interesting episodes where they ventured into surrealism or absurdity, where they drew on from Monty Python, and, you know, where they developed their odd sensibility and outlook. Anyway, stay tuned.